لا نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يذلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله. أما بعد، أعوذ بالله السميع العليم من الشيطان الرجيم، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إن الذين يتلون كتاب الله وأقاموا الصلاة وأنفقوا مما رزقناهم سرا وعلانية يرجون تجارة لن تبور ليوفيهم أجورهم ويزيدهم من فضله إنه غفور شكور. والذي أوحينا إليك من الكتاب هو الحق مصدقا لما بين يديه إن الله بعباده لخبير بصير. ثم أورثنا الكتاب الذين استفينا من عبادنا فمنهم ظالم لنفسه ومنهم مقتصد ومنهم سابق بالخيرات بإذن الله ذلك هو الفضل الكبير. جنات عدن يدخلونها فيها من أساور من ذهب ولؤلؤا ولباسهم فيها حرير. وقالوا الحمد لله الذي أذهب عنا الحزن إن ربنا لغفور شكور. رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقه قولي. اللهم ارحمنا بالقرآن وجعله لنا إماما ونورا وهدى ورحمة. اللهم ذكرنا منه ما نسينا وعلمنا منه ما جهلنا وارزقنا تلاوته آناء الليل وأطراف النهار وجعله لنا حجة يا رب العالمين. الحمد لله حمدا كثيرا طيبا مباركا فيه. We praise and thank Allah Azza wa Jal for every blessing, for every ni'mah, for every khair that is upon us, upon our children, upon our family, in our wealth, in our health. We thank Allah Ta'ala for the blessing of the Quran. We thank Allah Ta'ala for guidance. We thank Allah Ta'ala for everything of which we can account and know about, and for the immeasurable amount of blessings which we are completely and absolutely unaware. Allah Ta'ala, He is the one, He is the first and He is the last. He is the Zahir and He is the Batin. He is the owner of everything in the galaxies, in the stars, between the galaxies and on earth. Of the millions and millions of types of fish, of the millions and millions of the types of birds in the sky, and the millions of creatures that walk the earth. Allah Ta'ala is the designer behind it all. Allah Ta'ala is the creator of them all. Allah Ta'ala is the sustainer of them all. Allah Ta'ala knows every movement of every creature of His, and He knows where they shall die. He knows how they shall die, and He knows how they will be resurrected. Allah Ta'ala has created insan to test him. الَّذِي خَلَقَ الْمَوْتَ وَالْحَيَاةَ لِيَبْلُوَكُمْ أَيُّكُمْ أَحْسَنُ عَمَلًا. To test him, who amongst insan can achieve the best? Who amongst humans can become the best? Who amongst the humans can achieve the best? And for those who shall pass the test shall be rewarded with a home, a house in Jannah, where you shall never be asked to leave, and you shall have every blessing that you could ever think of and more. And that's just the beginning. And ultimately, you shall meet the most beloved, your most beloved, our most beloved, Allah Ta'ala Himself, and shall be surrounded by the cream of humanity, the Anbiya, the companions of the Prophets, those who followed them, those who lived by their teachings, those who called to their teachings, those who sacrificed for those teachings and revelation, and those who died by it. Jannah is promised. Jannah shall be rewarded with yaqeen. And there is not a single deed, there is not a single rak'ah that you pray, there is not a single sujood that you make, whether it's from fard or the nawafil, except that He is watching you, except that He shall reward you. Know that you're not doing these acts of ibadah in vain. In vain meaning for no purpose. In vain meaning because you just have to. No, the beauty of this deen is you are honored to stand before Him and pray and bow before Him and prostrate before Him. Not only does He answer your du'as of what you need, He appreciates. Today's dars is about inheritance. But the inheritance that we're going to talk about today is the inheritance of the Quran. People who inherit the Quran. There's some very beautiful ayat from Surah Fatir, beginning from ayah number 29. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَتْلُونَ كِتَابَ اللَّهِ وَأَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةِ وَأَنفَقُوا مِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ سِرًّا وَعَلَانِيَةً يَرْجُونَ تِجَارَةً لَن تَبُورَ. Indeed, those who recite the Book of Allah, وَأَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةِ, those who recite the Book of Allah, and some of the Salaf have explained the word tilawa as to follow. Not only does it mean recite, but follow. Follow it with words and follow it in action. It's telling you to do something, then follow it. Follow it as it's instructing you to do. So Allah Ta'ala says, indeed those who recite the Book of Allah, and that's a quality of the believer. How often are you reciting the Quran? How can we be believers or inheritors of the Quran and we do not have a portion of the Quran that we're reciting every day? The tilawa of the Quran in it of itself is as critical to you as oxygen is. Cut oxygen at any point of your body and immediately you'll start dying. Immediately. The difference between oxygen and food and drink and water is your survival rates differ. Like you could go a certain amount of time without food before somebody becomes ill, critical, dies. Water is a longer time period. You know, a person can survive on water longer without food, right? And food less. But then oxygen take 2, 3, 4 minutes max. All the trillion cells in your body will begin to die. We know trillions of cells are in the body, trillions. And this is why never you could thank Allah Ta'ala enough. Each cell requires oxygen. Each cell, there's trillions of cells. And the system of flow, like just like in a central heating system where you have pipes running and for the heating to get hot, you have hot water which is pumped from the boiler that goes through all the pipes into radiators. And if that water doesn't get there, it doesn't become hot. If the blood stream doesn't deliver oxygen to any cell, it'll start to die. And more will start to die. So tilawa of the Quran to the believer is oxygen. Not food. I'm not saying food and I'm not even saying drink. I'm saying oxygen. Some people think that my tilawa of the Quran, and I will say here something here, that whether you're doing Hifz or you're doing, you recite Surah Al-Mulk or you recite the Surah of the day, I do not believe this should count towards your normal portion of tilawa. Your tilawa of the Quran should be you covering the book of Quran cover to cover. It could be you could only do 2 pages a day. Doesn't matter. Page a day, doesn't matter. But finish your tilawa of the Quran to so many facets to a person's relationship of the Quran, from tadabbur to hifz to doing a tajweed to contemplating, teaching, exploring, learning, etc., etc. But tilawa itself is where it all starts. Tilawa itself is in a sense Allah Ta'ala sees a person's relationship with the Quran, and guidance is then either given or taken away in proportion to how much you're reading and how much nasr you need and how much help you need. إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَتْلُونَ كِتَابَ اللَّهِ وَأَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةِ. In this ayah, look at the sequence. If we were to say the sequence of importance, we would say salah first, zakah, reciting Quran. The description in this ayah is إِنَّ الَّذِينَ يَتْلُونَ كِتَابَ اللَّهِ وَأَقَامُوا الصَّلَاةِ وَأَنفَقُوا مِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ. Those who establish the salah, and then those who give from what we have provided for them, سِرًّا وَعَلَانِيَةً, secretly and openly. One point here, that وَأَنفَقُوا مِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ, they give charity from what we have provided them. You give a sadaqah from the risk that you have received. Don't belittle what sadaqah you give. You could be giving £10, and next person could be giving £1 million. But your £10 could be heavier in the scales than that million. And you give from what you have. Don't worry about trying to have too much, like think I need to give more money from whatever risk Allah Ta'ala has given you, give from that. And they give secretly and openly. So that's a sifat. Don't just be of those like, I'm only going to give my sadaqah secretly. Which you should. You should try to hide your deeds. But sometimes it is good, especially when it comes to sadaqah, to be encouraging for others, is to let it be known as well. So when we're doing a fundraiser here, you know, somebody could be, you know, it encourages others, is mashallah, he's given that much, I can also give. But the sifat is both. They give secretly as well. And secretly is critically important and is mentioned first. Give secretly. Have deeds of sadaqah that nobody knows about. Not your wife, not your siblings, not your children, nobody. That you give, only Allah. It's a secret. Look, those who give from what they have been given, secretly. So we know straight away, secret sadaqah is something which is pleasing to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because it shows true iman, isn't it? Nobody's going to pat you on the back. You know, even in the ayah, they do not desire even to be thanked. We don't want no reward back from you. This is the highest level. You don't even want a thank you. You're doing it so solely for Allah's sake. Like, you know the famous story of Umar Abdul Aziz. So there's a famous incident where a woman from Iraq, she may have been a widow, in the reign of Umar ibn Abdul Aziz, rahimullah, comes to visit the Khalif. And she's asking, where did the Khalif live? And they said, look, this house over here. She walks into the room. She finds a woman sitting there, no hijab. This man is plastering the wall. So she thinks to herself, she's told, that, you know, I think you'll find the wife of the Khalif there. So she's thinking, is the wife of the Khalif sitting here? Well, this man over here, he's nowhere, no hijab. What kind of place does this turn out to be? Yeah. Obviously, she came from far. So she says to the man plastering, she goes, you know, we have a guest, can you go get some food or hospitality? So he goes, comes, brings it back, sits in front of her and sits down and says, how can I help you? So the woman says, I've come to see the Khalif Umar ibn Abdul Aziz. He says, how can I help you? It was the Khalif who was plastering the wall, his own wall, because he had chosen, when he became Khalif, he had chosen not, I think after he was given the bay'ah, not to go back to the palace. Actually, I want to go live in a hut. This was the caliber of some of the khulafa, mashallah. So she says, look, I have this many daughters, and the governor, this is a letter from the governor, the governor's telling her that she has, you know, kind of like a verification, she's poor, she hasn't got, if you could help support her. So he says, so I think one of the Aziz starts writing a letter to that governor to say, okay, you know, I'm going to give you like an allowance, maybe a monthly allowance or yearly allowance. So he says to her, look, what's your daughter's name? She puts the daughter's name down. So the daughter, so she says, Alhamdulillah. So Umar ibn Aziz says, look, okay, what's your other daughter's name? So she tells him the name. He writes it down. She says, Alhamdulillah. He goes, okay, what's your other daughter's name? So I think the third, fourth, fifth one, she obviously gets even more happy, you know, over the moon. Then she says, you know, yeah, Amir al-Mu'mineen, thank you so much. You know, I really appreciate it. He says, that's it. As long as when you were thanking him, I was continue writing it. When you now thanking me, then okay, that's between me and you now. When, you know, we leave it as how many daughters that we put down. Because his caliber was, I don't even want to thank you. I'm going to do what I'm going to do to help you. I'm not going to even know. We would all, God didn't even say, you know, help the guy out. Yeah. And, but obviously when you're helping someone with that niya, and then doesn't even say, obviously it's a sign of ingratitude. Somebody doesn't say thank you, isn't it? So it's a sign of a qalb and a fitrah that's salim. When somebody does some khair to you, the person's over the moon and overjoyed and trying to repay in words and in deeds, trying to do some shukr. But the point is that these people who do deeds secretly, like, you know, we have reports from the time, from the life of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu and Umar radiallahu anhu, both separately, how they would secretly be cleaning some woman's home, old person's home, nobody would know. They would just do a disappearing act. And you know, many times, in many places, brothers getting up 2 o'clock in the morning to clean toilets. They are getting up 2 o'clock just to clean toilets because it's a secret deed for no one to know. And what are they doing? They're doing the most thing that nobody wants to do. But to gain his pleasure. And I think this is why we shouldn't, don't overlook anything that you're doing. And you know what? Really, you're living in great times. If you have opportunity to do good, you're living in awesome times. Amazing times. If you can achieve khair and good and you can do so much good and achieve Allah Ta'ala's pleasure in so much. Alhamdulillah. Many, many places in the globe, even now, where we would go, and you wouldn't be able to do khair and good. You just wouldn't be able to do it. You wouldn't be able to open your mouth. And here, I'm just saying that where we are. The opportunity of khair and good, do as much as you can wherever you are. يَرْجُونَ تِجَارَةً لَن تَبُورَ. Any business that you go into, any business that you do, if you've done business, there's always a fear of it flopping. And you basically not only breaking even, you're making a loss. There's always a fear. Because like, okay, you invest money in something, you buy goods, something happens, the circumstances change, you can't sell them. You know, you invested $5,000 on Atar, and you're able to sell 1,000, $4,000 is just sitting there. Even before you sold it, you're fearful, am I going to really make money on this? Potentially, you got two figures in your mind. Potentially, I can make $15,000, good money, but then I can make a big loss as well. Now I'm going to make a risk. What do I do? That's the nature of tijara. That's the nature of business. Allah Ta'ala says, these type of people are engaged in a tijara that can never end up in a loss. We're in business, brothers. We're in business. You can reflect on that. Why did Allah Ta'ala refer to these things as business? Because if you think in business, like you could really do stock market analysis on deeds. Stocks are up high, down, Dow Jones, blah, 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 3+ high, whatever, the rates got up. Okay, you can look at your day every day, how much deeds you've done and what you've done and how high or low. Because it's a tijara. So every letter of Quran you're reciting is 10 deeds. You're in a tijara. And the ultimate tijara is that if you get bought, إِنَّ اللَّهَ اشْتَرَى مِنَ الْمُؤْمِنِينَ أَنفُسَهُمْ وَأَمْوَالَهُمْ بِأَنَّ لَهُمُ الْجَنَّةِ. Indeed, Allah Ta'ala has purchased the lives and the wealth of the believers for Jannah. You want Allah buy me? May Allah buy us. It's amazing. One of the sheikhs is saying, think about this. Who owns you? Who created you? Who controls you? So what's the need to buy you? If he already owns you, why does he need to buy you? My reflection is, you can grow a tree. You grow fruit from a tree. Only some seeds become apples. Some seeds become fruits. When you graduate and you become the potential, then you get picked. Why would anybody want to buy a rotten apple? You don't buy a rotten apple. You don't buy rotten fruit. You buy what's worth buying. So if you're not worth buying, you're not going to get bought. And Allah Ta'ala says, He's bought from the believers, their wealth and themselves. So the commodity was you. What was used as an exchange for the money, the trade, what was traded in for was you get Jannah. And who was the buyer? Allah Azza wa Jal. May Allah Ta'ala bless us to be amongst those whom He buys. So Allah Ta'ala says, these people are those who are in business, but this business, they're making no loss. It is fully, like not only are you going to gain, you're going to gain big. لِيُوَفِّيَهُمْ أُجُورَهُمْ وَيَزِيدَهُمْ مِنْ فَضْلِ. لِيُوَفِّيَهُمْ أُجُورَهُمْ. In order, so, لِيُوَفِّيَهُمْ, so that He may give in full their ajr. وَيَزِيدَهُمْ مِنْ فَضْلِ. Not only will He give you the good deeds, the reward of the good deeds that you did, in full, He'll increase it by His bounty. So there's things which are next to deeds, which are given as a result of deeds. And Allah Ta'ala says, وَيَزِيدَهُمْ مِنْ فَضْلِ, and He increases by His fadl. إِنَّهُ غَفُورٌ شَكُورٌ. Indeed, He is forgiving and appreciate. He's the one who appreciates the most. When you're struggling, and He can see your struggle, and you fight on, He is shakur. He is grateful that you are doing this. I know the name of Allah Azza wa Jalla is so beautiful. So beautiful. And shukur is just an amazing, amazing meaning. Like shukriya, you don't say shukriya. That comes from the word shakara. Allah Ta'ala is indeed He is ghafoor, shakur, that He is not only going to reward you for what you did, He appreciates it. And you know, that's just on a different level. Like, to Allah belongs the most noble of examples. Like, you go to your manager, and the manager says, "You're in a fine job, my son. You deserve a bonus. So you get paid. You're on a salary of 1,000. And, you know, you hit your targets. You did very well. You got all the sales right. You know, I'm going to give you a bonus. The bonus is another 1,000. And then I'm going to increase you even more. And that's because I really appreciate all the effort you put in. You doing all that, you probably was expecting some of the reward, you're going to get the bonus, right? Because you thought, I'll hit my targets. I'll get my bonus now, because that's what I did. And I was expecting, and you had told me, and I'm going to get it. And you've given it to me. But the extra part is just like the icing on the cake. Those words to say, you know, one brother says to another, "Akhi, you know, I really appreciate the effort you're putting in, you know." You know, saying those words on top of everything else is on a different scale. So Allah Ta'ala is saying his name is Shukur. He is the one who appreciates what people do. And we are the sons of he whom the angels the sujood before. وَالَّذِي أَوْحَيْنَا إِلَيْكَ مِنَ الْكِتَابِ هُوَ الْحَقُّ مُصَدِّقًا لِمَا بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ. And that we have revealed to you, O Muhammad, of the book, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, is the haq, is the truth, and is مُصَدِّقًا لِمَا بَيْنَ يَدَيْهِ. It is confirming what they have with them. What they have of the Torah and the Injil, the Quran is confirming. It is fulfilling the prophecies that you find there. It's confirming it, it's fulfilling it. إِنَّ اللَّهَ بِعِبَادِهِ لَخَبِيرٌ بَصِيرٌ. Indeed, Allah Ta'ala with His slaves is Khabir and Basir. He knows what's happening, and He's Basir, meaning He's actually watching. Then comes the ayah that about the ayah of inheritance. ثُمَّ أَوْرَثْنَا الْكِتَابَ الَّذِينَ اسْتَفَيْنَا مِنْ عِبَادِنَا. Then we made to inherit the book those whom we chose from our slaves. So from our people who worship Allah Ta'ala, from the Ubad, Allah Ta'ala picks some of them. All of them? No, some. Some from the Muslimin. Those who deserve to get picked. May Allah Ta'ala make us amongst them. So it's like, imagine your father, you know, your father in his inheritance, he puts all the sons down, names down except yours. How do you feel? Very upset. Or he puts one son's name down and nobody else's. How do you feel? Very upset. So Allah Ta'ala writes some slaves to inherit His book. Meaning some, not others. And I have to admit, I actually understood this ayah when I read it all. I understood it differently as opposed to what I read today from what seems to be like the majority of the riwayat and the ulama saying about who this... Because there will be three categories that Allah Ta'ala will mention. Three different types of people whom Allah Ta'ala has chosen to inherit His book. So Allah Ta'ala says, عز وجل ثُمَّ أَوْرَثْنَا الْكِتَابَ الَّذِينَ اسْتَفَيْنَا مِنْ عِبَادِنَا فَمِنْهُمْ ظَالِمٌ لِنَفْسِهِ وَمِنْهُمْ مُقْتَصِدٌ وَمِنْهُمْ سَابِقٌ بِالْخَيْرَاتِ بِإِذْنِ اللَّهِ ذَلِكَ هُوَ الْفَضْلُ الْكَبِيرُ. So those who inherit the book, from amongst them are those who do dhulm upon themselves. Amongst them are those who are like middle of the path, and amongst those who are sabiq, right at the front, forefront, by the permission of Allah, that is the great fadl. ذَلِكَ هُوَ الْفَضْلُ الْكَبِيرُ. This is understood, these three types of people, the majority, from what I understand of the scholars, believe all these three are destined for Jannah. Even the one who is a zalim against his nafs. I understood it before to be, and there are some of the Salaf who said that this first type of person, he's the one who's not fulfilling his duty towards the Quran, right? But what they say is, the first type of person, Allah Ta'ala chooses, but he's doing zulm against himself. He's trying, but he's making mistakes. But he's been chosen, and he's doing zulm against his nafs. And the second type of person who's inheriting the book is, he knows about the Quran, but he's moderate. Like if you eat this food in moderate proportions, moderate is just a small amount, like average amount. And then there's those who are front line, sabiqun bil khayrat. If we understand it, like the majority of the ulama understand it, that from these people that Allah Ta'ala has chosen or chooses, that's a great honor in of itself. So being chosen is a great honor in of itself. to be given inheriting the book. And we'll discuss here now, what does it mean to, how can we inherit the book? What does it mean to inherit the book? Because everybody else, you recite the Quran and they recite the Quran. So what makes the inheritor different to this other person? Because they're both reading the Quran, right? What's the difference between the one who's inherited it and the one who hasn't? There's narrations that speak about how all three will be going to Jannah. Even the one who does zulm against himself, like he's inherited it. It's a heavy book.
Yeah.
But there's hope that even if you're... And the thing is, you know what, look, remember this rule. This rule, I'm telling you now, remember for the rest of your life. Never, ever, no matter what sin you even committed, no matter what you feel, no matter what's happened, be debilitated from what you need to do for what Allah Ta'ala says. Like, you've fallen over, you've made a massive mistake. An immature person stops there. Immature, I don't mean immature like, I mean in age, I mean in deen, in your iman, immature in that sense. That you, because something's happened, you stop doing something. You have some waswas, something's happened, but you're carrying out your duties that you know that Allah Ta'ala has put upon you. You carry on and never let it be debilitate you. Man qara al-Qur'an, whoever recites the Qur'an, faqad, then he reaches the level, the daraja of nabuwa, baina jambayhi ghayra annahu la yuha ilayh. He reaches the level of prophethood without any wahi coming to him. In the footnote, there's a narration that whoever takes a third of the Qur'an, this is key here, man akhada ثلث القرآن وعمل به فقد أخذ ثلث النبوة. Whoever takes a third of the Quran and practices it, does acts by it, then he's taken a third of prophethood, nabuwa. And whoever takes half of the Quran and acts by it, the 6,000 over 6,000 ayat, ask yourself the question: how many of them have you put into action? And if you haven't, do so. For if the more you do, the higher level you become, as if that you've received nabuwa yourself. So then imagine what state you may get reached with next to Allah Azza wa Jal. And this is why somebody who is not a scholar, not an alim, did not go anywhere to study, did not fight anywhere, he will reach a higher place in Jannah than the person who knew more. Because of his amal. So if you only knew one ayah and acted by it, and somebody knew all six books of hadith by heart, but didn't do amal by it, you're higher. And what was the way of the sahaba? Learn 10 ayat, act by it, then move on to the next. Memorize it, act on it, go on to move on to the next. That was the routine, right? And then whoever takes the whole Quran, acts by it, will have taken the all of Nabuwa. What makes you first worthy to be chosen in the first place? ثُمَّ أَوْرَثْنَا الْكِتَابَ الَّذِينَ اسْتَفَيْنَا مِنْ عِبَادِنَا. First, you have to be on top of your ibadah. مِنْ عِبَادِنَا. Meaning from our slaves. Meaning from those who are engaged in our ibadah. You have to be people of ibadah. Men of ibadah. Men of the nawafil. Men of salah. He sees those who are deserving. Nobody should be mistaken in thinking you have to be perfect. It's not about being perfect. Nobody's perfect. Except Allah Ta'ala chooses as the prophets. We're all going to make mistakes. That's not the point, is how much you're trying to correct yourself and be that perfect human being. It's not a bit like saying, okay, oh, nobody's perfect, so we're not going to even try to be. No. Acknowledge that you can make mistakes. Acknowledge you do make mistakes. But try your utmost to be of those whom Allah Ta'ala sees. Somebody, the deeds that we do, they have to be Quran in action. Quran in action, i.e. how you are, in why you're giving sadaqah, how you're giving it, how you're looking at someone, brother, how you're approaching somebody, how you're being nice, how you're not, how you're being tough, how you're not, what you're doing, why you're doing, when you're doing, how you're doing, with whom you're doing. All these are human interactions. When is Quran that's dictating the way that you're doing, it's the prism through which you see the world. Allah Ta'ala may choose you and say, okay, you know, he heard from my words this, so he acted on it. And then let me see how he did. And maybe he does something. And he sees, as I said, he sees everything big and small. May Allah forgive us all our sins. Being chosen, and hopefully even these ayat will be seeds for us to think about. But being chosen is a challenge in and of itself. May Allah chooses. Number two, once you've been chosen, Now you can possibly fall into three categories. You don't want to be in the first. You don't want to be of those who are sinning and doing zulm at the lowest end. And why do we say we want to be muqtasid? Let's be sabiqun bil khayrat. We want to be a star, top. Be right at the forefront. Sabiq is the one who is on the front line of salah. He's sabiq. And you use that equation for every deed. So something needs doing, first to do it. Some sadaqah needs to be giving, first to give it. Someone needs help, be the first to be there. Be first in, run, strive to be the first. And that is, Allah Ta'ala says, this is key. This, the third type of person, Allah Ta'ala says, he's sabiqun bil khayrat bi idhnillah. Meaning you're not going to be able to achieve sabiqun bil khayrat except by the idhn of Allah. That's a reward of you trying to be sabiq, that Allah Ta'ala opens the doors, He's giving you permission to be able to do deeds which are at that high level. Because the reward is so high. Allah Ta'ala says, this is ذَلِكَ هُوَ الْفَضْلُ الْكَبِيرُ. What's the reward of all this? Of being chosen? جَنَّاتُ عَدْنٍ يَدْخُلُونَهَا يُحَلَّوْنَ فِيهَا مِنْ أَسَاوِرَ مِنْ ذَهَبٍ وَلُؤْلُؤَ وَلِبَاسُهُمْ فِيهَا حَرِيرٍ. For them are gardens, يَدْخُلُونَهَا, forever being inside, يُحَلَّوْنَ فِيهَا مِنْ أَسَاوِرَ مِنْ ذَهَبٍ وَلُؤْلُؤَ, which they will enter, and they will be adorned therein with bracelets of gold and pearls, and their garments therein will be a silk. So, the most beautiful of clothes in this world where we should be of the zuhad, we should be of the ones who do zuhd. But everybody likes wearing nice clothes. Everybody likes wearing the most beautiful attar. Everybody likes eating the most beautiful food. And everybody likes the most beautiful opposite gender as well. No one likes anything ugly. In actual fact, the more beautiful the thing is, the more nicer you feel. Like somebody can give you some attar which is nice, and some attar which is nicer, and one more nicer. Now, those grades, of utur, didn't they give you different emotions? They did, didn't they? Some touched you a little bit. So, that's very nice. That is on another, and as Brother Hamza would say, something like, next level. Just like food is nice, this was just amazing, this is on another level. And everything, and in Jannah, every desire that a man has, which we do not even need to go into, it shall be fulfilled to the most top scale you cannot even imagine. Actually, what you can imagine, let's just imagine, what you can't even imagine, right? What you can't even imagine, it's going to be at least that. The most beautiful of anything you can imagine, it's going to be at least that. Just that would be, Jannah is worth going to, is it not? Even just what you can imagine, it was Jannah not worth trying to strive for, if it was just that. But Allah Ta'ala will make things which will be for maximum pleasure. Jannah is to maximum pleasure. Like, you have tongue palate, and you have millions of cells, and you have some foods which you touch. Maximum pleasure will be hitting every cell of pleasure. So you can imagine Jannah. May Allah bless you, Jannah. Now listen to this. And these are the words. What they're going to say when they're in Jannah. وَقَالُوا الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ. They say, all praise be to Allah Ta'ala. Alladhi, He is the one. Adhaba anna al-hazan. He is the one who removed all sorrow, all depression, all pain. Any anxiety that you had, any pain that you had, any stress that you had, is gone. وَقَالُوا الْحَمْدُ لِلَّهِ الَّذِي أَذْهَبَ أَنَّ الْحَزَنِ. It's gone. It's just all gone. Like, we know the narration, the one who had the most pleasure in this dunya, when he'd be dipped in the fire once and asked, did you taste anything good in your life? He'd say, never. And the one who suffered the most in this dunya and enters Jannah and sees and smells and tastes that from Jannah and would be asked, did you suffer anything in dunya? So Jannah is this place of maximum pleasure. And Allah Ta'ala has reserved and reserved for His slaves. May Allah make us amongst them. Inna Rabbana la ghafurun shakur. This one, notice what happened here. Allah Ta'ala had told them when in the beginning of these ayat, Allah Ta'ala had said, He'll reward them fully for what they did, increase them in their fadl. He is ghafurun shakur. In Jannah, that was what Allah Ta'ala had said. In Jannah, when they enter it, they'll say, Allah, our Lord is ghafurun shakur. Like, now we've seen it. We can see that he was appreciative. Although some may see in this dunya, even if they recognize it or they don't, they'll know it happens in dunya. But in Jannah, they say, Allah Ta'ala, indeed he is the one who's forgiven. May Allah forgive us our sins. And he is the one who's shukur. He's the one who's grateful. He appreciated what we did. الَّذِي أَحَلَّنَا دَارَ الْمُقَامَةِ مِنْ فَضْلِهِ لَا يَمَسُّنَا فِيهَا نَسَبٌ وَلَا يَمَسُّنَا فِيهَا لُغُوبٌ. He has settled us in the home of duration of Jannah out of his bounty. There touches us not in it any fatigue, and there touches not us not in it any weariness or any tiredness. You can't even really fathom that, you know, internal happiness. Like you know when you have a good laugh, how that feels. You know, it's true. I mean, the most amount, I think for men especially, the time that you are happiest really is when you're with brothers, you're having a good time. Good laugh, you're out, you're joking, you're messing about, you're having a laugh, you're doing all these things. That's when you're most happy, right? But imagine being with friends in Jannah forever. That itself is worth sacrificing everything for. And Allah Ta'ala has prepared for His slave that which no eye has seen, no ear has heard, and no mind has even grasped. As Allah Ta'ala says in Surah Sajda, تَتَجَافَ جُنُوبُهُمْ عَنِ الْمَضَاجِئِ يَدْعُونَ رَبَّهُمْ خَوْفًا وَتَمَعًا وَمِمَّا رَزَقْنَاهُمْ يُنْفِقُونَ فَلَا تَعْلَمُ نَفْسٌ مَا أُخْفِيَ لَهُمْ. No nafs knows what's been hidden for him. You don't know what's hidden for you. مِنْ قُرَّةِ أَعْيُنٍ جَزَاءً بِمَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. That they don't know all these things which will give you so much pleasure. What's been hidden for you. That's Jannah. So the Quran is a big responsibility. We'll finish by saying, you know, about some of the responsibilities that we can think of with respect to the Quran in inheritance. In inheriting the Quran, if we were to list them, we would say from the characteristics of inheritance of the Quran would be to recite the Quran beautifully, to follow its instructions, to try to understand its instructions, to obey those instructions, to call to the Quran, and be ready to sacrifice for the Quran. Your relationship to Quran is in direct relation to Allah Azza wa Jal. You're hearing the words of Allah Ta'ala. And we know from the hadith of the Prophet Sallallahu Alaihi Wasallam, when Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu noticed white hairs in the Prophet, he said, Oh Prophet, I've noticed you're going white, going old, aw kama qal. And the Prophet said that Surah Hud, and some other surah of the Quran, they made me old. Surahs of the Quran made me old. Think about that. What does that mean? Surahs of the Quran made me old. Meaning, this is not a joke. This is not a light. This is heavy. Heavy in what Allah Ta'ala is saying. Because once you understand this is haqqul yaqeen, then these are not just mere words that you are reading. This is the truth that you are reading. So may Allah Ta'ala bless us to be amongst those whom He chooses to be of those who inherit the book. May Allah Ta'ala forgive us all our sins. May Allah Ta'ala erase our sins from our books. May Allah Ta'ala raise our ranks high. May Allah Ta'ala bless us to be amongst those whom He chooses to be from Ahlul Quran. May Allah Ta'ala bless us to be from amongst those whom He grants the highest places in Jannah. May Allah Ta'ala make all our affairs easy for us. May Allah Ta'ala bless us and answer our du'as. May Allah Ta'ala bless us to reach Ramadan. Ameen bil khair. May Allah Ta'ala guide us aright. And may Allah Ta'ala make everything easy. Whatever Allah Ta'ala makes easy is easy. And whatever Allah Ta'ala leaves to ourselves and is hard even though it may be very, very small. So may Allah Ta'ala, you know, kill our hearts, mend our hearts, guide our hearts. May Allah Azza wa Jal forgive us for all our shortcomings. If there's anything correct that I have said, then it's from Allah Ta'ala and Allah Ta'ala alone, and all praises for Him. And if there's anything incorrect, then it's from myself. May Allah Ta'ala forgive me and forgive us all. رَبَّنَا اغْفِرْ لَنَا ذُنُوبَنَا وَإِسْرَافَنَا فِي أَمْرِنَا وَثَبِّتْ أَقْدَامَنَا وَانْصُرْنَا عَلَى الْقَوْمِ الْكَافِرِينَ. آمين. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك.